Jesus took with him Peter and James and John, and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. And then Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say, for they were terrified. And then a cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud there came a voice, "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." And suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no one with them anymore, but only Jesus. And as they were coming down the mountain, he ordered them to tell no one about what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
And so, here you are, about 70 AD, and you're part of the believing community in a city called Thessalonica. You've already heard Paul's letter to you, to return to a letter you sent about many questions to him, and he answers you. And you've heard several things. You've heard about Jesus Christ crucified, resurrected from the dead. You've heard about law and gospel, about good news over and against the law that may define you as a broken person. And yet, in that death and the resurrection of Jesus, you have new life. Some of you are Jewish converts, some of you are Gentile converts. And into the midst of your community one day comes a scroll. It is a papyrus scroll, and I have here even some which will show you. And this comes directly from Egypt. It is the type of papyrus that would have been used, wetted down, pressed together. And as this scroll is unrolled and it's flexible, on it are letters in black Greek. And the story of the fulsomeness of Jesus is told to you for the first time. It fills in all of the blanks, so to speak. Because Paul hasn't told you everything. He has told you very little about John the Baptist. He has told you very little about Jesus' baptism. And now all of the stories that you haven't heard are now being unfolded to you for the first time in what we call the Gospel of Mark, even though when it's first read, it is not marked as Mark because it would come later. And you're sitting and you're listening, and now you hear John the Baptist. And then you hear of Jesus' baptism. Then you hear of him walking into a town, and there's a boy who is in seizures. It is said he is possessed by an evil spirit. And all of a sudden, in front of you, unfolds this Jesus and his first really big conflict with evil. And in that conflict, in the breaking of that spirit of evil from the child, people are looking on and saying, "What is this all about?" You've heard this for the first time. Paul hasn't told you. These are new stories for you. And then the next story arises about Peter, James, and John, about how Jesus takes them to this mountain. And before them, he becomes transfigured. And around him is this glow of absolute white. And if you are from a Jewish background, you will recall suddenly Moses' face surrounded by light as he came down from the mountain with the Ten Commandments. If you're a Gentile, then you need to learn this story. Nevertheless, they are there. And who is Jesus talking to? Moses, the lawgiver, Elijah, the one who was taken up in the fiery chariot. Two major prophets, leaders of their time, talking with Jesus as if somehow there was a final fulfillment in this Jesus of Nazareth talking to these two men. And in the midst of it all, Peter, who is overcome and sees it as the most beautiful thing he has ever seen in his life, mumbles, "Oh," because he's terrified, "Oh, Jesus, let us set up houses, huts, tents for you, for Moses, Elijah, so that you can stay here, stay with us, because we want this to last and last." And so you, the new audience to this gospel we call Mark, hear this story, and then it ends. And then Jesus is telling the disciples, "Don't tell anybody about this. Don't say a word until the Son of Man has risen from the dead." Imagine the confusion. And now, after this absolutely glorious story, now come the other stories if you have never heard. All about Jesus, his encounter with people, how he raises people from down and me in the dust, how he meets them, how he walks into their lives and changes their lives. An encounter with Jesus never leaves you the same. It does something, it renews you, it almost opens up to you a person that you never knew until you walked into his presence or he walked into yours. And you're listening, you new Christians, in that year 70 AD, and the story goes on. But the story starts to get darker, for suddenly there's opposition against this man who does good, goes around, and the opposition comes from the traditions of what people believed at that time. And now there's all kinds of secrets whispered. He's not who he says he is. We're not even sure who he is. And now, one who confronts and destroys evil is being accused of being evil. The absolute opposite of what goodness is all about. It is now about an hour later, and you're moving through the Gospel of Mark. And you realize that somehow this Jesus is walking closer and closer to a destiny that you never realized would have happened to him, despite this saying of Jesus saying, don't tell anybody about this now till the Son of Man is risen from the dead. You forget all those things because you're looking at this man as a Messiah. And every one of you has this idea, what on earth is a Messiah? What is he supposed to do? And every one of you has a different idea of what you want this Messiah, this Son of God, this Son of Man, to be in your life. But then doubts start to arise, because as you get deeper and deeper into this scroll of Mark's gospel, he's getting closer and closer to a destiny as he gets closer and closer to Jerusalem. And you have forgotten that story of transfiguration, of all that glory, all that light, and all that splendor, because now the very evil that he sought to break seems to be in charge. So it is for those who are against him. Bring charges against him, and he's dragged up in front of Pontius Pilate. And all of the stuff that you had hoped for in this man is being destroyed, sentence by sentence, as you sit there and you listen to this gospel unfold. And now there is betrayal. Even one of his own disciples betrayed him. And now all of a sudden he's dragged away. He's beaten, crowned with thorns, dragged up again, cross put on his shoulder. You have no remembrance of transfiguration whatsoever. Because now, everything that you are called to believe in the messages that St. Paul has given to you, in his preaching and in his letters back to you, suddenly the fulfillment of a story that Paul didn't tell you completely all the details become harrowing. They become terrible. But that's not us, is it? You've heard the story of Transfiguration many, many times. It's always on this Sunday before we walk into Ash Wednesday. You've heard it all before. So it's not like those people back then who heard it for the first time. We're hearing it again for I don't know how many times before. And we say, I think when Transfiguration Sunday comes, I think we're going into Lent. Yep. I'll know for sure when next Sunday when they come in, all the fire is replaced with purple. Yep. That's a sign we're in Lent. The real question, of course, is there anything that's going to surprise you as you hear the Gospels during Lent? Is there something different that has happened into your life that all of a sudden has meaning to you that it never had before? Is the surprise of everything we hear read out of the Gospels as we approach Holy Week say something to you that brings you into a greater understanding of what this whole story of Mark is all about? And that is, of course, is what we call a Lenten challenge. It is a challenge to take something old that we've heard over and over again, dig deep, and in that digging, find something new for you to hold. It may even only be one sentence for you to carry around with you. If it is, write it down and take it with you. Put it where you can see it. So that as you journey through Lent, as we come next Wednesday and we mark ourselves with ashes, as a reminder of our own mortality, that beyond our own mortality is the story of this Jesus, transfigured on a certain day in front of three of his disciples, and then walks through this story that Mark unfolds in front of us and says, come, follow, find out what real love is all about. And as you follow this, you will be almost destroyed as you walk into a Good Friday service, for you will discover what sacrifice and love is really all about. And in so doing, you may discover in Easter this year that will supersede anything you have ever experienced before. And so, that little community, after 2.5 hours of hearing the story, it's over. And you can surely bet that there are many questions that they have. And so it has been all through the centuries. There's been questions about anybody who's baptized into Jesus' name, because now it has to become an integral part of our lives. And somehow, it isn't always congruent. But really, the question is that our problem or God's? And as we walk into Lent, maybe it's the perfect time to discover that congruency all over again. And as we do, we begin to discover that we are indeed, as John said, God's children now. And as such, children of God, whom Jesus called the Father, and for whom Jesus' love would supersede anything we had ever seen before. It's coming Lent, and it's time for us, not so much to put on any type of piety or sadness, but rather to dig deep into the actuality of our own lives and say, how does this story come into mine? How do I claim it for my own? How do I claim it for the good of the world? Lent is a beautiful time. It is a time to rediscover what we say our faith is all about. And may God grace us all during these next weeks as we approach Holy Week, so that we enter into that time asking the questions that we didn't dare to ask before, knowing full well that there's going to be a fulfillment